Hi friends, again welcome to another episode of Machine Design. Today we're gonna talk about polar moment of inertia and how it's related to torsion. So if you remember, in the previous video we had talked about mass moment of inertia, right? Now this is another concept, polar moment of inertia, and it's very simple. Consider this a circular disc mounted on this red shaft. Okay, now if it's being rotated, the mass moment of inertia concept was there were many point masses, okay, and when we rotate this, they resist that angular acceleration if you try to accelerate or increase the angular velocity, right? Well, in this concept, polar moment of inertia, it says that this, when it's being rotated, it resists torsion. Okay, so if this disc was fixed on this shaft and if I'm trying to rotate it, it doesn't want to rotate, and we are, you know, creating a shear, and it's getting what you call sheared, right? So in that case, polar moment of inertia is really helpful. The other case was it was being rotated freely and it was related to angular acceleration. That is, the rotation speed is going to be changed, increased or decreased. That is where the angular acceleration comes into play. In this disc is fixed on this shaft and it's not free to rotate, but we are applying torque and it's trying to be rotated. That time, there are, you know, I have shown different dots. They represent different areas, small areas, which need to be integrated in this equation. That is, if you remember, in the previous equation for mass moment of inertia, it was I equals integral of r square dm, right? Because it was all about point masses. In this case, it's given by integral of r square dA. So basically, it tells us that it's square of the distance. Again, it's the same like before, and it's depends upon the area. So let's see how it affects torsion or the torque. It says it's measure of an object's ability to resist torsion, right? This is the torsional equation. This is a very fundamental equation that is being used to solve the problems related to shafts and keys and all. So let's see, the equation says torque by polar moment of inertia is equal to, this is tau, that is the maximum shear stress withstandable by that particular material, if it's steel or copper, whatever. R is the radius, okay, let's check out with this figure. R is the radius, okay, this end is fixed, okay, this end is fixed, and we are the same case, this disc was fixed over this shaft, and you know, its natural free rotation is prevented, but we try to, you know, rotate it. The same way, this shaft is fixed on this plate and we are applying a torque T to rotate, I mean to, you know, shear on this. We are applying a torque so that this will get deformed like this, right? So R is the radius of this shaft, okay. Tau is the maximum shear stress withstandable by this material. T is the torque. J is the polar moment of inertia of the shaft. G is the modulus of rigidity. Theta is the angle of twist. Angle of twist means, if initially if this point was here, after I applied torsion, this point, you know, got, you know, changed to this position, position 2. Position at position 1, I mean the point was at position 1 before. After I applied torque and twisted it, after the twist, point 1 reached point 2. So that is the angle of twist, that theta. And G is the modulus of rigidity, L is the length of the shaft. So this is the torsional equation, and you can see that polar moment of inertia is here, right? And this is the torque. So if you use this part to solve this any problems, If you put J here, it says as J increases, torque also increases, right? So what it means, radius of the shaft, if it's fixed, torque, you know, the tau, the shear stress, that is dependent upon the, it's dependent on the material, right? Then the thing that varies is this one, right? So J is also fixed, but we can decide the shape, right? The size of the shaft. So what I'm trying to say is, torque will be proportional to polar moment of inertia. If polar moment of inertia is more, this shaft can withstand more torque. That's what it says, or transmit more torque without failure. So, or the same case, you can use this equals this, the same would happen, right? So that brings us to another, a very, you know, famous example, that most of the cases for saving the weight of the material or the cost cutting, or in most of the cases for power transmission and all, solid shaft is being replaced with hollow shaft, right? The reason being, the hollow shaft has to be a little bit more size than the solid shaft, but we can save a lot of mass in this, you know, middle part, and we can cut down the weight and the material. How? Because as you can see, J is proportional to this, it's after you integrate, it becomes R cube, right? R cube by whatever, it becomes R cube. So what I'm trying to tell is that anyway, it's getting more than R, I mean R square. So if this J is proportional to a higher degree of radius, as the radius increases, its effect on J would be very high. So if you increase the radius, J would increase definitely, right? And you can see this part, the central part, would contribute very less to the polar moment of inertia, right? Say a point here would contribute more. The same point, if it was here, it would contribute less to the polar moment of inertia, because its radius is smaller at center and it's bigger at the outer end, right? So for a hollow shaft, we threw away all this useless, you know, the mid part that contribute less to the polar moment of inertia, and we took only the good part, the outer part. So that's the advantage of hollow shaft over solid shaft. It helps to get the same or more polar moment of inertia, and hence more torque, by saving material, but you have to increase the radius a bit more than the solid shaft. So that's all about polar moment of inertia and torsion. Thank you.